श्री सच्चिदानंद सद्गुरु साईनाथ महाराज की जय। ब्लेस्ड इज द फेस ऑफ साई, इफ ही कैस्ट अ ग्लांस एट हिम फॉर अ मोमेंट ही डिस्ट्रॉयज द सोरोस ऑफ मेनी पास्ट बर्थ्स एंड कन्फर्स ग्रेट ब्लिस ऑन अस, एंड इफ ही लुक्स एट अस विद ग्रेस आर बॉन्डेज ऑफ कर्मा इज इमीडिएटली स्नैप्ड अवे एंड वी आर लेड टू हैप्पीनेस। The river Ganges washes away the dirt and sins of the people who go to her for a bath, but she intently longs for saints to come to her and bless her with their feet and remove all the dirt accumulated in her. Samartha Sai is the crest jewel of such saints. Knowing these are his words, devoted and virtuous people hear this purifying story with great reverence. When I remember Sai with love and the love that he has for his devotees, my mind forgets its nature and I am at peace, notwithstanding the problems of the worldly life. Sai Samartha himself is the story, the narrator and the narration. Why and how is Hema there? It is just an assumed name. Now let's hear a story. Baba said, one morning after taking my breakfast, I strolled along till I came to a small river bank. As I was tired, I rested there, washed my hands and feet and had a bath and felt refreshed. There was a footpath and a cart track sheltered by shady trees. The breeze was also blowing gently. As I was preparing to smoke chillum, I heard croaking of a frog. I was stinking the flint and lighting the fire when a traveler turned up, sat by my side, bowed to me politely and invited me to his house for meals and rest. He lit up the pipe and handed it over to me. The croaking was heard again and he wanted to know what it was. I told him that a frog was in trouble and was tasting the bitter fruit of its own karma. We have to reap now the fruit of what we sow or do in our past life, and there is no use of crying about it. Then he smoked and handed over the pipe to me and said that would go in person and see it for himself. I told him that a frog was caught by a big snake and was crying. Both were very wicked in their past life and are now reaping the fruit of their actions in these bodies. He went out and found the huge black serpent which was holding a big frog in its mouth. He turned to me and said that it is about 10 to 12 minutes that the frog would be eaten by the snake. I said, no, this can't be. I am its father, protector, and I am here now. How shall I allow the snake to eat it up and I here for nothing? Just see how I will release it. After smoking again, we walked on to the place. He was afraid to ask me not to proceed further as the snake might attack us. Not minding him, I went ahead and addressed the creatures. Oh, Veerabhadrappa, has not your enemy Basappa yet repented, though he had been born as a frog, and you too, though born as a serpent, still remain bitter enmity against him. Fie upon him, be ashamed, give up your hatred, and now rest in peace. Hearing these words, the snake left the frog quickly and dived into the river and disappeared. The frog also jumped away and hid itself in the bushes. The traveler was much surprised. He said that he could not understand how the snake dropped the frog and disappeared at the words uttered. Who was Veerabhadrappa and who was Basappa? And what was the cause of their enmity? I returned with him to the foot of the tree. After sharing a few puffs of smoke with him, I explained the whole mystery as follows. There was an ancient temple sanctified of Mahadev about 4 to 5 miles from my place. The temple was old and dilapidated. The residents of the place collected funds for its repairs. After a large amount was collected, arrangements for worship was made and the plans with estimates for repair which was prepared. A rich local man was appointed the treasurer and the whole work was entrusted to him. He was to keep regular accounts, be honest in his dealings. He was a first class miser and spent very little for repairs, which consequently made little progress. He spent all funds, swallowed some amount himself and spent nothing from his pocket. He had a sweet tongue and was very clever in offering plausible explanations regarding the poor and tardy progress of work. The people again went to him and said that unless he lent his helping hand and tried his best, the work would not be complete. They requested him to work out the scheme and collected again subscriptions and sent the amount to him. He received it but sat as quiet as before without making any progress. After some days, God, Mahadev, appeared in his wife's dream and said to her, "You should get up, build a dome of a temple. I will give you 100-fold of what you spend." She told this vision to the husband. He was afraid that it would involve him some expenses and therefore laughed at it, saying that it was a mere dream, a thing not to be relied or acted upon. Why did not God appear to him and tell him? Was he far off from her? This looks like a bad dream, having for its object creation of ill feeling between the husband and wife. She had to remain quiet. God did not like big subscriptions and donations collected against the wishes of the donors, but he likes ever trifling amounts given with love, devotion, and appreciation. After some days, God again appeared in her dream and said, "Do not bother yourself about your husband and the collections with him. Don't press him to spend any amount for the temple. What I want is feeling of devotion. So give, if you like, anything of your own." She consulted her husband about this vision and decided to give God her ornaments given by her father. The miser felt disconcerted and decided to cheat even God in this item. He undervalued the ornaments at ₹1,000 and bought them himself, and in lieu of the amount gave a field of God's endowment as a security. The wife agreed to this. The field or the land was not his own. It belonged to one poor woman named Dubhaki, who mortgaged it to him for ₹200. She was not able to redeem it for long. So the cunning miser cheated all, his wife Dubhaki and even God. The land was sterile, uncultivated and worth nothing, and yielded nothing, even in the best seasons. Thus ended this transaction, and the land was given in possession of the poor priest, who was pleased with the endowment. Sometime later on, strange things happened. There was a terrific storm and heavy downpour of rain. Lightning struck the house of the miser, where he and his wife both died. Dubhaki also breathed her last. In the next life, the rich miser was born at Mathura in a Brahmin family and was named Veerabhadrappa. His devoted wife was born as the daughter of the priest of the temple and was named Gauri. The woman Dubhaki, the mortgager, was born as a male in the family of Gurav, attendant of the temple, and was named as Chinnabasappa. The priest was a friend of mine. He often came, chatted and smoked with me. His daughter Gauri was also devoted to me. She was growing fast and her father was seeking for an alliance for her. I told him not to worry about this, and bridegroom himself would come seeking her. Then there came a poor boy named Veerabhadrappa of their caste, wandering and begging his bread to the priest's house. With my consent, Gauri was given in marriage to him. He was also a first devoted to me, as I recommended his marriage with Gauri. Even in the new life, he was hankering after money and asked me to help him to get it, as he was leading a happy man's life. Strange things happened. There was a sudden rise in prices. By Gauri's good luck, there was a great demand for land, and the endowment land was sold for 1 lakh. 10 times worth her ornaments. Half the amount was paid in cash. The remaining was to be paid in installments of ₹2,000 each. All agreed to this transaction but began to quarrel over money. They came to me for final consultation. I told them that the property belonged to God and vested in the priest, and Gauri was his sole heiress and property risk, and no amount should be spent without her consent, and that her husband had no right whatsoever to the amount. Hearing my opinion, Veerabhadrappa was wroth with me and said that I wanted to establish Gauri's claim and embezzle her property. Hearing these words, I remembered God and kept quiet. Veerabhadrappa scolded his wife Gauri, and she came to me at noon and requested me not to mind the words of others and not to discard her as she was my daughter. As she thus sought my protection, I gave her a pledge that I would cross 7 seas to help her. That night, Gauri had a vision. Mahadev appeared in her dream and said, "The whole money is yours. Do not give anything to anybody. Spend some amount for temple purpose in consultation with Chinnabasappa. And if you want to use it for some other purpose, consult Baba in the masjid myself." Gauri told me that the vision I gave her the proper advice in the matter. I told her to take the principal or the capital amount herself, give half the amount of interest to Chinnabasappa and Veerabhadrappa. had nothing to do with this matter. While I was thus talking, both Veerabhadrappa and Chinnabasappa came quarrelling. I tried my best to appease them and told them God's vision. To Gauri, Veerabhadrappa got wild and angry, threatened to kill Chinnabasappa, cutting him into pieces. The latter was timid, he caught my feet and sought my refuge. I pledged myself to save him from the wrath of his foe. Then after some time, Veerabhadrappa died and was born as a snake, and Chandrabhadrappa died and was born as a frog. Hearing the croaking of Chinnabasappa and remembered my pledge, I came here, saved him and kept my word. God runs to his devotees for help in times of danger. He saved Chinnabasappa the frog by sending me here. All this is God's leela or support. God does not like contributions given without love due to pressure under persuasion or coercion. A little gift given with love is very precious. Allah comes running for his devotees at times of their troubles. He had sent me here to protect his devotee. Hemad surrenders to Sri Sai. I encourage all Baba devotees to read the Sai Satcharitra every day and soak in Baba bliss. Baba bless you. Om Sai Ram.